It's a big question that people give for not believing in the Christian faith, and it's probably one of the main reasons why people turn away from the Christian faith as well, or at least the reason they give. So it's an incredibly important thing for us to be thinking about. And of course, we live in a very beautiful world where we see God's extraordinary power and creativity and goodness in so many ways. But we also live in a world where there is a lot of suffering. And let's just reflect on the different types of suffering that there are. And I'll go through this very, very quickly, but think first of natural disasters. I live in a country, New Zealand, or I grew up, where earthquakes and volcanoes are a big part of our history, many different episodes over the years. Many parts of the world are suffering from earthquakes, volcanoes, floods, and particularly in low-resource countries, the effects of these are often greater because there are large populations in vulnerable places who are not properly protected. And then, of course, there's drought and storms, tidal waves, plagues, and we're in the middle of probably what's going to become the eighth worst plague in human history in the next couple of months when the death toll reaches 2 million from COVID. So there's natural disasters, there is, of course, disease. And this is what we would be without a job as doctors and dentists if it weren't for disease. And of course, there are many different varieties. Most people die of a disease or an accident at some time in their lives. And of course, the diseases that are most distressing to us are those for which there is no treatment or cure, and particularly when they involve children, very, very hard. And then there is increasingly recently the threat of terrorism, where innocent people suffer. So all of us who are alive remember 2001, 9/11, when it happened, and episodes of terrorism which seem to happen with increasing regularity in our world. And then there are accidents, many of them the result of technology or the collateral damage, that road, air, rail, sports accidents, which may result in death or disability, which might be lifelong. And then, of course, there is man's inhumanity to man, whether it's broken relationships in marriage, within families, between people who were once friends, between countries and tribes, violence, murder, war, refugees. And then there are the things that we do to ourselves, especially through addictions, be it to drugs or processes that happen. So there's a very quick survey. Our world is one where there is a lot of suffering. And the suffering can be physical or it can be mental. So we're familiar with the symptoms that our patients suffer from with various diseases, but also recognition that a lot of suffering is mental, that a lot of suffering involves loss, whether it's the loss of loved ones through a broken relationship or bereavement, loss of possessions, job, skills, reputation, dignity, loss of face in many cultures is a huge thing, especially in East Asia, or whether it's mental illness and a great variety of those. So it can be personal or physical, but there are also, you could say, two types of suffering, and that there's the suffering that happens to us or our loved ones on the one hand, and the suffering that happens to someone else who we may know or maybe elsewhere. And of course, the impact on us is much, much greater if it is involving ourselves. You know, when I look back on my own life, in many ways, growing up in New Zealand, working in Africa as a missionary doctor, and then the UK, I have been insulated from a huge amount of suffering that is a big part of the lives of others. But the biggest events in my life have been involving around loss, when my best friend, my wife's brother, was drowned at the age of 37, very successful pediatrician, believer, just completely out of the blue, or losing a baby halfway through pregnancy. So it's these unexpected losses that have been big things for us. And all of us can think back on our lives to painful episodes that involve loss to us personally. And of course, that hurts us much, much, much more than things that happen to people a long way away that we do not feel personally. And so it's important to remind ourselves that even though there's a huge amount of suffering in the world, the amount that each individual suffers personally is much more limited, but also varies from individual to individual. Now, suffering is not just a problem for Christianity, but it's a problem that all religions and worldviews attempt to address in some kind of way. And the approach of each worldview is different. So in Islam, and you may think this is to some degree a caricature or a summary, but I'm just trying to get at the heart of what each religion says about suffering. Suffering is very real in Islam, but there is this almost fatalistic sense about it that if suffering happens, it's the will of Allah, he's willed it, you can't resist his will. There's just a sense that it is the result of fate, that what happens to us. In Hinduism, there is, of course, the belief that we're locked in the cycle of birth and death and reincarnation. So we die, then we come back as some other person, and the life that we live in our new life is a consequence of actions and choices in a past life, so that we're living out the consequence of bad karma. And so there is a fatalism in Hinduism too, that a person who's poor or marginalized or suffering from some disease or loss, in a sense, deserves it because it's retribution for a past life. And so a lot of Hinduism centers around the giving of sacrifices to gods like Hanuman, pictured here, in order to appease them and end up with a different load of karma in the future. And then Buddhism is based on this idea of the Four Noble Truths. So, and the first truth is described by the word dukkha, which means suffering. So everything is suffering. Life is suffering, death is suffering. Every person encounters suffering. But the Buddhist idea is that suffering is due to desire, and so related to loss. And so the idea is that it's because we desire things. We desire relationships, we desire to be loved, we desire possessions, we desire a certain lifestyle. And because of that desire being unfulfilled, we therefore suffer. And so the path to freedom in Buddhism is just to rid yourself of all desire, extinguish all your desires. And then as a result of that, you eventually reach nirvana, where you escape from the cycle of death and rebirth. So there's a sense in which Buddhism says that suffering is largely, in a sense, in the mind, that it's a result of the desires that we have that we should relinquish. And then the atheist, of course, there's no God, there's no life after death, there's perhaps no right and wrong. We just live in a world that's governed by physical forces and laws completely beyond our control. And human beings are just the product of matter, chance, and time in a godless universe. So Richard Dawkins' famous quote, DNA neither knows nor cares. DNA just is, it's just random molecules, and we dance to its tune, he says. So there's a kind of fatalism there in atheism as well. So you've got these different solutions that different religions or worldviews produce. It's just fate, it's just retribution for a past life, it's just a state of mind, it's just random chance. And there are elements in all of these that we would agree with as Christians. There's an element of truth in all of these approaches. But there's also a sense in which Christianity can't take refuge in these solutions, because we believe in a God, first of all, who is omnipotent, which means that he's all powerful, he can do anything. And he's also a God who is omniscient, he knows everything. And he's a God who's benevolent, who's kind, loving, and compassionate. So if God can do anything and he knows everything and he's kind, then he must know about suffering. He must be able to do something about it. And he he must want to because he's compassionate. So why doesn't he do something? And so this has been one of the arguments that atheists in particular have put to argue that God probably doesn't exist, because if he did exist in the form that Christians believe in, then there wouldn't be any suffering. And you get this expressed eloquently by certain famous atheists. So here's Stephen Fry, who's a British comedian, very famous actor, and utterly despising of Christianity. How dare you create a world in which there's so much misery? It's utterly, utterly evil. So he sees God as capricious, mean-minded, stupid, and so on. Richard Dawkins, of course, the evolutionary biologist who we've referred to earlier, this is his famous sentence about the God of the Old Testament: jealous, petty, unjust, unforgiving, control freak, so on and so forth. Or slightly more dated version, George Bernard Shaw: how are atheists produced? In 9 times out of 10, it's because of this: a beloved wife or child or sweetheart is gnawed to death by cancer, stultified by epilepsy, struck dumb and helpless by apoplexy, that stroke, or strangled by croup or diphtheria. So he's talking about old diseases now, of course. But the onlooker, after praying vainly to God to stop, becomes not merely indifferent and skeptical, but fiercely and actively hostile to religion. So he's saying that many people lose their faith as a result of suffering. So we've seen the scope of suffering in the world, the approaches of different religions to it, and the argument that's used against Christianity in its purest form and in its popular form. Now, of course, what's very interesting, of course, is that when we look at Christianity, the Bible is no stranger to suffering. And in fact, at the very heart of Christianity is the idea of a suffering God who took on suffering and entered our world as a human being and became obedient unto a cross in order to save us and pronounce us innocent before God and rescue us to a new heaven and a new earth. So Christians have always believed in spite of suffering, indeed because of suffering. In fact, suffering is one of the most powerful arguments for the existence of God and the gospel itself. And the idea that suffering is a problem which proves that Christianity can't be true is actually a very, very recent idea in human history. It really developed mainly subsequent to the Enlightenment in the 18th century. And it developed out of this idea that God was kind of there to satisfy our desires and make life pleasant for us, rather than any biblical idea of God. And so Christians throughout the centuries have developed different ways of looking at suffering. And of course, when we look at the world as Jesus described it, he said all of these things would happen, and they have. When he spoke to his disciples on the Mount of Olives, he said that these things would characterize the last days from his first appearance and death and resurrection and up until his second coming. And so Christian philosophers have developed what are called theodicies, or if you like, explanations of why evil and suffering exist. And I want to simplify that for you by putting them under 4 main categories, which I use when I'm explaining this situation to a non-believer or to Christians. 4 big defenses of why suffering exists and why we should expect it and how we should be thinking about it. And you notice that each one begins with the letter F, which makes it much easier to remember. So here they are. First of all, suffering is there because we live in a fallen world. We believe that we live in a world which is the way it is because of the rebellion of conscious beings, not just human beings, but angels. You might recognize here, Samuel, maybe the fountain of the fallen angel in Madrid. but it's based on this idea that demons, and in fact the devil himself, were once created good as angels. They're created beings, but they rebelled against God. And so they now live in defiance of God and are seeking to do evil things. So it wouldn't surprise us that in the world we would see a huge amount of suffering because there are fallen angels. But then, of course, also human beings are fallen. And when human beings rebelled against God, there were consequences, not just for their relationships with each other, but the whole of creation fell. And so in Genesis 3, we see the development of weeds and pain and childbirth and mortality. All these things are a consequence of the broken relationships between God and human beings, between human beings and other human beings, and between human beings and the planet itself. So we live in a fallen world where the devil is very active, but we shouldn't imagine that he's a free agent as well, because we're told that the devil is like a dog on a leash. He can only do what God allows him to. And so we see in the book of Job, Satan has to come and ask God for permission to afflict Job with illness and take away his children and so on. Or Satan has to ask Jesus's permission in order to sift Peter in the Gospels. And so Satan is not an equal and opposite agent to God. He's very, very limited in his power, and he can only do what God allows him to do. And God will only allow him to do what ultimately leads for God's glory. And so we're involved in a spiritual battle, but we only see part of it, because the actions of angels and demons and all of the drama happening behind the scenes is invisible to us. But it shouldn't surprise us that we live in a world where there's great suffering. But remind ourselves always that God is sovereign, so that anything, Genesis 50:20, Joseph said to his brothers, "You intended it for evil, but God intended my slavery for good, for the saving of many people. That's why he made me the number two in Egypt, to save the Egyptians and my family from famine." And this is why we see passages like 2 Samuel and 1 Chronicles 21, which seem to contradict each other when they're talking about the census that David ordered, because in one of them it says that God incited David to take a census, and in the other it says that Satan incited David to take a census. Well, which was it, God or Satan? Well, the truth is that actually Satan did it, but he did it under the sovereign power of God. God allowed it to happen for God's greater glory, and we can see that looking back in history. So we live in a fallen world. Then number two, we live in a world where there's free will. So humans are not robots. We are given choices, and we can use those choices to do evil. If this was a world where God miraculously intervened to stop every evil thought or evil action, we would not have freedom. We would just be robots. God wants us to worship him and follow him freely. And so he's given both human beings and angels and demons free will. They can make actions on their own. And if we think about the world and how many of the things, bad things that happen in the world are the result of free will, it's a very, very long list. And there are the obvious things, the sins of commission, where people are actually doing bad things. War, famine, alcohol, drugs, violence, accidents, and the things we looked at already, but also the sins of omission. So bad results when we do bad things, but it also results when we refuse to do good things. And if you think about the so-called acts of God, natural disasters, how many of them would the suffering have been so much less if it hadn't been for human negligence? You know, how many people die in earthquakes because of badly built buildings, or buildings built in the wrong kinds of places and so on? How much disease is due to negligence, people not using the cures that are available or making them more freely available? So this is John F. Kennedy, who was, of course, assassinated in 1963 as the President of the United States. And he said, "We now have the knowledge and resources to provide food water, clothing, health and education for every man, woman and child on the planet. All we lack is the will. And he was saying this more than 50 years ago. Well, how much more true is it today with all of the technology and scientific things that we have at our disposal? We instead just lack the will. We could do so much good, but we choose not to. So those are the first two F's, the fall and free will. Number three is that we have to look at suffering through the eyes of faith. And if you think of the Christian faith itself, if you look at the crucifixion of Christ in isolation, it seems meaningless. But when you see it through the eyes of faith, that his death and resurrection makes it possible for us to have a relationship with God, to know forgiveness, to be born again, to be clothed with his righteousness, and to be participants in the new heaven and the new earth. We say that that suffering, which in the case of Christ was huge, saves us a huge amount of suffering, because otherwise we would be lost. And C.S. Lewis talks about suffering being God's megaphone to a deaf world. In other words, suffering wakes us up to our predicament and makes us act. It can produce endurance and character, that God works for good through it, that is part of God's discipline. And so it's even something that can be rejoiced in, because we see that God is using it to shape us and make us into the kind of people that he wants us to be. And the pearl effect, a pearl is produced because of grit in the oyster. So the oyster reacts to a piece of sand that's placed in it by producing this beautiful pearl around it. And in the same way, God uses the suffering and the difficulty in our lives to build our characters and make us into the kind of people that he wants us to be. And they especially talk about the pearl effect with regard to families with profoundly disabled children, that a hugely disproportionate number of people come out of those situations wanting to care for and love others because of what they've been through themselves. And then the fourth F is the future. So we have to see suffering in the world in the context of the future, in the context of what we know is going to be done. So we look forward to a day of judgment when everything will be put right. And the day of judgment is not just that people getting their just deserts, but it is also everything being put right. And God cannot save his people without destroying their unrepentant enemies who stand in the way. And so we look forward to a new heaven and a new earth, that this world is not our home, we're passing through it. And in fact, this world is just the shadow lands, what C.S. Lewis called it, prior to the real existence, which is life in all eternity with God and a new heaven and a new earth where we have bodies like Christ was after the resurrection, and where there's going to be no dying or suffering or pain, Revelation 21, 1-4. And so it's a reminder that even though Jesus healed many people, he came not to empty the hospitals, but to empty the graveyards, and that our focus is on what's coming. And then, of course, that raises the question, well, why the delay? Why doesn't God bring this future now? And the answer is very clear to Peter 3:9, that God delays in order that people may reach repentance. It's because of his compassion that he doesn't bring this judgment, because as C.S. Lewis again says, once the author walks on to the stage at the end of the play is over. It's too late to change sides. And so the day of judgment is delayed out of God's compassion and mercy in order that more and more may hear the gospel, be saved, and enter into God's kingdom. And so we see the future, this description from Paul's letter to the Corinthians, no eye has seen, nor ear has heard, no mind has conceived what God has prepared for those who love us, that it's absolutely beyond our wildest dreams what's coming. And a couple of chapters further on in 1 Corinthians 4, he talks about the eternal weight of glory that's coming, that in the context of which all the suffering on earth seems, in his words, light and momentary, even the worst of it in the context of what's coming. There's that that verse in John 16:25. It is where he talks about childbirth and says that when labor is over and the child is born, the joy outweighs any of the suffering. So that the mother, even though she's been through this traumatic experience of labor, once she's holding the little baby, she's filled with joy, and the pain of it is forgotten, so that we see things in the context of the future. And of course, you know, that there are huge big questions, and perhaps the biggest question is not so much why does this happen, but why did it happen to me now in my life? And there is great mystery often, because we're not in the position of God, where we see the reason for everything and we see how he weaves all of the things that happen in this world, good or bad, into a beautiful tapestry. We only see the other side of the tapestry with its loose strings and ugliness. And so that brings the practical question of how we respond to suffering. And there are, of course, wrong responses and right responses. And these are some of the wrong responses that Christ talks about: becoming bitter, blaming others, you know, it was the woman you gave me, and so on, as Adam says to God, complaining, becoming despairing and resentful, or wanting to escape into all the wrong kind of things. So there are wrong responses to suffering, but there are also right responses. And part of that is, even though we can't explain every, you know, aspect of suffering, even in retrospect, we know that there are reasons why it does occur and must occur, that we've just looked at, the four F's of fall, free will, seeing it in the context of the future, and through the eyes of faith. And so the right response is not to be wallow in the problem, but to be part of the solution. And in the same way that Jesus annihilated suffering in others through his acts of healing and compassion and took suffering on himself, that we are called to do the same thing. So that's the understanding why. J.I. Packer, who wrote a wonderful book, Knowing God, which if you can get a chance to read it, it's a wonderful, wonderful book. But he talks about people, two kinds of people in this world. He said, on the one hand, there's people who stand on a balcony in relative comfort, and they, you know, they make statements about the world and so on. And then there's the people who are the travelers, who are walking along the road. And he said each one of them entertains different questions. So the people on the balcony are saying, well, how is it that suffering can exist in a world where God's all powerful and he knows everything and he's supposed to be compassionate? And they make their judgments. But the traveler is not asking those kind of questions. He's asking the question, how can I get over the next hill? Or how do I deal with these blisters that I've got? Or how do I help this person, who's fellow traveler, who's fallen on the side of the road? So he's asking practical questions. And this quote, which Professor John Wyatt is very, you know, loves this quote, and you'll often hear him speaking about this: suffering is not a question which demands an answer. It's not a problem which requires a solution. It's a mystery which demands a presence. And so one of the best things that we can do is just to be there for people, not necessarily with the answers. I remember when I was a medical student, and one of my classmates who was not a believer, he was going out with this girl with whom he was very much in love. She was a Christian. And she was tragically killed in an accident where she was riding a bicycle into the city and a truck went round the corner and she was knocked off and killed instantly. And he was absolutely devastated, my friend. And I remember us going round there after the accident, and there were, you know, were friends were coming around trying to comfort him. And of course, there was absolutely nothing that you could say in that situation. And so all we could do was really just be there and just sit there, and there were a couple of us Christian friends of his, and when all the others left and they went out the door, and he just broke down and wept inconsolably as he was, you know, just trying to deal with this whole situation. And of course there was nothing to say, but it was really important, as we learned later, that we were just there with him as he was crying through this. And so this is what it means, the mystery which demands a presence. We don't know the answers, but we have to be there for people. And so much of what we see in the scriptures is God doesn't give intellectual answers as to why suffering is there, although as we've looked at, they are certainly there. But it's the promise of his presence with us through them. And not just the fact that he never leaves us nor forsakes us and is with us through all of these things, but actually that he's walked this world as a man and so understands what it is to suffer and has been tempted in all ways as we are, and is our constant presence in the things that we face. And so this is why it's so important that our response is not one of turning and railing against God, but actually walking in his footsteps, being part of the solution, carrying the cross, and like the Lord, shouldering suffering ourselves and being part of the answer to it. And I think a career in medicine and dentistry is very much that. There is a lot of difficulty and hardship along the way, and going through a difficult course, passing these exams, dedicating one's life, learning as an apprentice how to do it. But of course, at the end of that, you end up with these amazing skills and abilities where you are able to make such a phenomenal difference in people's lives, physically and also mentally as well, because you are there at some of the worst moments of their life. It's a wonderful privilege. And so we mentioned Job earlier, but you know, we live in a world where there are unseen forces at work, where there's a time just for silence and lament. The problem Job's comforters made was that they tried to give too many answers and accusations rather than just being there with him. But we live in a world where Christ's death and resurrection are the solution, that it's leading to a restoration in the future, and that there's mystery that we can't answer. So this is the alcoholic's prayer. You may be familiar with this. Give me the grace to accept the things I cannot change, to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. So there are some things that we can do something about, we should, but there are some things that where we can't. We may not be able to meet the need, but we can demonstrate in our lives how the need can be met. Stanley Brown was the leprosy doctor who couldn't meet the need of leprosy, but he demonstrated through his personal approach to it and the surgical skills he learned and passed on, how if there were others who followed in his footsteps, the need could be met and the need can be met. Mother Teresa to the communist, you do it, you care for people for an ideology, but I do it for a person who went before me and died on the cross for me. So we see it through hope, because we know the certainty of what's coming, and the future is as bright as the promises of God, which are always reliable and will be fulfilled. And we know that his will ultimately be done, and that anything we face is in comparison light and momentary in the light of it.